It's a real pleasure to offer you all a very warm welcome to the annual Montefiore lecture, which is, as Claire mentioned, in honour of Claude Montefiore. For those of you who don't know, Claude Montefiore lived between 1858 and 1938 and was a major theologian and founding leader within the movement of liberal Judaism in the UK. He helped to found the Jewish Religious Union in 1902 and served as president of the World Union for Progressive Judaism from 1926 until his death. Montefiore was a noted philanthropist, but also a great scholar. He was a pioneer of interfaith dialogue and produced scholarship in the fields of ancient Jewish history and theology and its relationship with Christianity. He published particularly on the relationship between Judaism and the New Testament, famously writing some of the first Jewish commentaries on the Synoptic Gospels in English. Some of his most notable works include Judaism and St. Paul in 1914, and a two-volume commentary on the Synoptic Gospels published in 1927, and Rabbinic Literature and Gospel Teachings published in 1930. This remarkable theologian and scholar and educator was also the president of what was then the University College Southampton, from 1913 to 1934, a very long time for a modern vice chancellor. The Montefiore Lecture was established in his honour in the 1950s and is the oldest established public lecture in the university calendar. Indeed, it was when attending a Montefiore Lecture that James Parks was prompted to donate his library to Southampton in 1964, and that in turn led to the establishment of the Parks Institute for the Study of Jewish Non-Jewish Relations. The Parks Institute today is a community of scholars, archivists, librarians, students and fellows whose expertise and interests span history, modern languages, music, archaeology, English studies and film. The Hartley Library is home to the wonderful holdings of the Parks Library and Jewish archive collections, and also the books on Judaism and Jewish Christian relations from Montefiore's own collection. Tonight's speaker is particularly appropriate choice to deliver this year's Montefiore lecture, which, as Claire said, is dedicated to the memory of Andrea Reiter, a wonderful colleague who we all greatly miss. Professor Joachim Schlur is a professor of modern Jewish non-Jewish relations here in Southampton and a member of the Parks Institute. His research interests are in the cultural history and the ethnography of migration and mobility, of urban life, and of the reflection of history in the individual experience. Many of his publications are based on personal documents, letters, diaries, photo albums of German Jews who emigrated to Palestine or elsewhere after 1933. He recently published a book about Julia Neuberger's mother, entitled Escaping Nazi Germany, One Woman's Emigration from Heilbronn to England, published by Bloomsbury in 2020. Is the co-editor of our journal, Jewish Culture and History, and co-editor of the new online journal, Mobile Culture Studies. So tonight, we are very fortunate to hear him speak on translation as a creative response to the experience of exile. Joachim, we very much look forward to your lecture. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark, and welcome everybody. I'm really honored to be able to talk tonight in the memory of our dear colleague Andrea Reiter. This is a somber occasion. I still want to start on a lighter note, and Claire, if possible, can we have the first song, which is from My Fair Lady, The Rain in Spain.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
What was that?
The rain in Spain stays main. The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
What was that?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
again.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
I think she's got it. I think she's got it.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it. By George, she's got it. Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
In Spain, in Spain.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Bravo!
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
In Hartford, Hereford and Hampshire.
Hurricanes hardly happen. How kind of you to let me come.
Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain.
And where's that blasted plain?
In Spain, in Spain.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. Oh. The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Many of you know this, obviously, but it might come as a bit of a surprise for you that many Germans think that My Fair Lady is indeed a German musical comedy set in Berlin. This is mainly due to the translator of the libretto and the songs, Robert Gilbert, who, after a stormy career in Weimar Berlin before 1933 and a long period of life in exile, had returned to Europe in 1951 and accepted the challenge put to him by the composer Friedrich Loewe, to translate Alan J. Lerner's libretto into German. The original premiered on Broadway in 1956, the German version in Berlin's Theater des Westens on the 25th of October 1961. This talk, which is dedicated to the memory of Andrea Reiter, results from two different areas of research. One is my own interest in Robert Gilbert's work and in the different cultural milieus where his lyrics and songs have been written, late Weimar Berlin as a center of avant-garde popular culture, Vienna before the Anschluss of 1938, Paris as a place of temporary refuge in 1938-39, New York then as a place of exile after 1939, and finally Munich and Zurich as places of remigration after 1951. The second research area has been developed by members of the Parks Institute, led by our late and deeply missed colleague, Professor Andrea Reiter. Jewish places as arenas for translation and transfer in Jewish-non-Jewish relations was the working title of a project that tried to connect notions of place with the idea of translation and transfer, with the idea of combining elements of the so-called spatial turn in the humanities, and the translational turn, and to seek answers to the questions of, to the question of what it is that makes a place, and how place making works through language and translation. How have Jewish places been constructed and negotiated, and what was the role of languages and of translations in these processes? David Roskies has described the relationship between Jews and non-Jews as a marketplace of voices. So trying to make sense of the discourses acted out in such places, the project aimed to demonstrate the strategic importance of translation in Jewish non-Jewish relations across the ages, to consider the significance of place in such relations from a geographical, historical, and cultural point of view, and to describe in what ways these various places can be understood as arenas of encounter and dialogue. Studying translation as a form of exchange and of co-construction, in the words of David Beale, can provide us with the opportunity to link the areas of research into migration and displacement with that of Jewish non-Jewish relations. Translation is itself a method of crossing boundaries, translation and transfer of languages, of values, of beliefs, of histories and narratives from past to present, of ideas from one culture into another or from one medium into another, can be regarded as a central link between the experiences of displacement and the adventure of integration and settlement. Translation provides actors with a chance to reinvent themselves. It is relational, interactive, and process-oriented, to use notions developed by proponents of a histoire croisée. Translation has the potential for performing identity, which has allowed Jews to exist in bi or even multicultural communities of discourse, and often bestowed on them the function of bridge building. Translation and transfer as cultural practices are of specific importance in places of emigration, where the experience of rupture and interruption requires new forms of interaction and communication. Such places, as I said, Berlin shortly before the Nazis rise to power, Vienna between 1933 and 38, Paris before the outbreak of World War II, New York during the war years, but also the cities of post-war Europe, can be regarded as such specific arenas where boundaries are challenged and crossed, and the link can be made between agents and processes of translation and transfer. So much for the introduction. The first task of this paper will obviously be to make you familiar with some of the central figures who will emerge in this text and whose names might mean nothing to you, although some will surely be able to sing or to hum some of the songs they wrote. Jan Richard Heimann, the composer who cooperated with Robert Gilbert on many occasions, both before and after the war, put that very fittingly into words which can be found today on one of the Berliner Gedenktafeln on the front wall of his former house, built by Erich Mendelssohn on Karolingerplatz 5 in Berlin West End. Sie kennen mich nicht, aber Sie haben schon viel von mir gehört. You might not know me, but you have heard a lot from, or obviously in English rather, about me. Well, this is the memorial plaque at the front of his house, and also shows him as the author of an important song in that context. Irgendwo auf der Welt gibt's ein kleines bisschen Glück, somewhere in the world there's a little bit of happiness, written together with Robert Gilbert. The very fact that the names are forgotten is due to the political circumstances. The Nazis rise to power, the persecution of Jews and political opponents after March 1933, and their emigration from Germany. In some ways, one could say, this emigration is not yet over, and although both Heimann and Gilbert, as well as Hermann Leopoldi and Hans Sahl, whom we also will meet, did indeed come back to Europe in the early 1950s, it is safe to say that none of them did really settle or make their home here anymore. Instead, they lived, to use a notion that has become very popular in recent years, transnational and transcontinental lives. The first figure I want to talk about is Robert David Winterfeld, born in the poor eastern part of Berlin in Warschauer Straße, as it says in a poem, above the horse stables, in 1899. That's him. He was the son of Max Winterfeld, a circus orchestra conductor and composer, who already had changed his name to Jean Gilbert in a city that aspired to become a European metropolis and in those years saw Paris as its role model. With one successful operetta, Die Keusche Susanne from 1912, which contained the Schlager, Puppchen, du bist mein Augenstern, Jean Gilbert managed to fulfill the Berlin dream of moving westward and living in a villa on the Wannsee Lake shore. His place today belongs to a divers club after having hosted the Institute for Silviculture under the Nazis and well into the post-war period, so no traces of its former owner can be found. After fighting in World War I, Robert returned a pacifist and a socialist. He had inherited his father's musical talent and hoped to put it to use supporting the political left in Germany. His song, Stempellied, composed by Hans Eisler and interpreted by Ernst Busch, the Barrikadentauber, Richard Tauber of the Barricades, became an icon for Germany's workers' movement, an indictment of the capitalist system and of those above, die da oben, for sending the unemployed masses into misery and despair. Gilbert also collaborated with Hans Eisler and performed at festivals for new music in Baden-Baden, 1927, and other places. During these years, he also established a lifelong friendship with the philosopher Heinrich Blücher, who would later marry the political scientist and writer Hannah Arendt. When he married himself and felt the need to earn serious money, Gilbert, although in the beginning he hated it, he said, he started to work for movies and operettas, and within a very short time became Germany's most prolific and highest earning songwriter. With Heimann, Gilbert wrote the songs for two films that you might know, Die drei von der Tankstelle, for example, Ein Freund, ein guter Freund, and Liebling, mein Herz lässt dich grüßen. For another film, Der Kongress tanzt, about the Vienna Congress, das gibt's nur einmal, und das muss ein Stück vom Himmel sein. And for Ralph Benatzky's operetta Im Weißen Rössel, he wrote the songs that made the play so successful. Im Weißen Rössel am Wolfgangsee, im Salzkammergut, da kann man gut lustig sein. Und was kann der Sigismund dafür, dass so schön ist? So, and here we see the two of them, Heimann at the piano, Gilbert singing, and this is their famous song, Irgendwo auf der Welt, somewhere in the world. Obviously, they wouldn't know in 1930 that it would take them anywhere in the world. In the period that ended in 1933, Gilbert really was a major actor in and contributed to Germany's popular music industry. In the spring of 1933, most, although indeed not all, of the German artists connected to the movies and shows referred to above, under the new ruling set by the Reichskulturkammer, emigrated, initially with the hope of return to neighboring countries. Vienna provided Robert Gilbert and other ex-polis with venues for performances and colleagues such as Hermann Leopoldi and Rudolf Weiss to collaborate with, as well as a related language for songwriting. This period between 1933 and 38, when, according to Karl Kraus, the Reds were entering the sinking ship, was marked by fruitful collaborations and successful performances. But the lyrics of the songs, and the poems Gilbert wrote, are clearly influenced and overshadowed by what was to come, civil war and the Anschluss, Hitler's entry into Austria. The lighter muse of the Berlin years made place for sarcasm and dark humor, but at the same time, it is indeed fascinating, had we more time, to see how Gilbert picked up the Viennese dialect, the first lesson, one might say, in cultural transfer. In Paris in spring 1939, Robert Gilbert reunited with his wife Elke and daughter Marianne, met up with Heinrich Blücher and Hannah Arendt again, and managed together all the documents needed to board the ship Aquitania on March 25, 1939, from Cherbourg to New York. The family settled in the Bronx, and for the next 12 years, 51 West 236th Street in Riverdale, quite a long way from Manhattan, became a home away from home. While the daughter's memoirs, published in English as Memoirs of a Mischling Becoming an American, and translated into German under the title Das gab's nur einmal, yet another song, Verloren zwischen New York and Berlin, lost between New York and Berlin, gave the impression that only she, Marianne Gilbert Finnegan, managed to become an American, whereas her parents, especially her father, remained stuck in exile circles. Robert Gilbert's letters to Weiss and papers documenting the collaboration with Leopoldi in New York tell a slightly different story. The years following Austria's Anschluss, the year, so 1938 and the following, was marked by the typical experiences of emigration, a search for a job and accommodation, applying for visa and affidavits, the loss of German citizenship. Transitioning his own career to another country across the Atlantic was an experience fraught with challenges. Das ist ein verflucht hartes Land, this is a damn tough country, Gilbert writes The Rule of Vice on June 24, 1939. The need to learn the new language was as obvious as the need to develop new topics and adopt a new style in the writing of songs and of music. This next part of my paper will reconstruct the cultural situation of those emigrants in the New York of 1939. In some ways, the ground for their cultural activities had already been prepared. New York obviously has developed and transformed as a result of emigration and the founding of Landsmannschaften, associations for the mutual support of immigrants who came from the same places, cities, or regions of origin, had already provided millions of Jews from Eastern Europe with the opportunity to start their American lives, supported by a familiar environment. But in Robert Gilbert's case, at least, things were not easy. The only flat his family could afford was far up north in Riverdale, and Elke Gilbert, now the family's official name was indeed Gilbert, earned the money they needed as a beautician and dressmaker in Lower Manhattan. Robert was often alone at home, as the daughter remembers, trying to write lyrics and music, and the old piano wore the many cigarette burns as a symbol of little success. The crucial point and problem for the writer was obviously language. The daughter, he remembers, acquired American English easily. Marianne spricht schon Englisch wie ein altes Mayflower girl, and began to forget her German. He later remembers, I've lived in America for 10 years. It was for me a very, very good time. I came with $300, lent from somebody, and landed in a horrible apartment under awful circumstances and had to try to earn money. How could I do that? My English was not as good as that of somebody who had grown up on these streets. I have grown up on the streets of Berlin. My knowledge of Shakespeare hasn't helped me here at all. I had to learn slang. Gilbert and his wife applied for and took on U.S. citizenship in 1944. And from the few letters of the period that I could find, I've got the impression that they intended to stay and not return to Europe. But the problem they faced was how to make a living. The letters to Weiss are full of projects and dreams, not many of which were ever realized. But most of them touch on or actually deal with the topic of language and of translation. Gilbert wrote poetry in German and performed sometimes for a public of 200 or 300 fellow emigres who were able to understand him. He worked for small fees as an accompanist on the piano for other artists. Ich habe meine Berliner Gedichte aufgesagt zur Freude der Menschen, die es verstanden, oder ich habe andere begleitet. I forgot to translate this one, just a second. Die Honorare waren minimal, so I performed my Berlin poems to the enjoyment of those who could understand them or accompanied European artists for minimal fees. The only publication of the period is Meine Reime, Deine Reime, You Verses, My Verses, which appeared in a German publishing house based in New York, and for which Hannah Arendt, in her book Menschen in finsteren Zeiten, called Gilbert the successor Heinrich Heine never had. One of the famous pictures of Hannah Arendt on the right-hand side together with her husband, Heinrich Blücher. One of the artists Gilbert had collaborated with in Vienna, Hermann Leopoldi, a survivor of the Buchenwald concentration camp. He was even forced to write a Buchenwald song by the Nazis there, but he was liberated and survived, and his family provided him with a visa and he arrived in New York, was more successful at the start since he did not hesitate to use the existing network of Austrian and Austrian Jewish immigrants. Performing in Eberhard's Café Grinzing in Manhattan, where he also met his partner for the stage, for life, Elie Möslein, they created a new and urban form of play, the short operetta, 45 minutes. They set up an echten Grinzinger Weingarten, authentic Grinzing vineyard, and served liver soup and schnitzel with salad, plum dumplings, and coffee together with the music. With songs such as I'm a Quiet Drinker or A Little Cafe Down the Street, they celebrated their arrival in exile cafes, for example, the Old Vienna or the Viennese Lantern. Somehow, songs about wine and coffee houses or about the beautiful girls of Vienna seem to touch the heart of the American public, whereas the harder, more serious, more political tradition that Berlin brought and Gilbert brought to New York remained within the circle of German Jewish immigrants. Or it traveled further on to Los Angeles, for example, where Werner Richard Heimann was quite successfully writing music for movies, such as To Be or Not to Be, directed by Ernst Lubitsch. But Gilbert sat in New York, complained about the summer heat, wrote poems and satirical texts for the German language emigre paper Aufbau, participated in a competition for the best German language exile song and won it with Paul Dessau's music, with a song with a very symbolic title, Höre uns Deutschland, Hear Us Germany. He also participated in the Austrian cultural programs, collaborating with Robert Stolz, one of the very few non-Jewish artists who decided to leave the native Austria, for example, in the restaging of Das Weiße Rössl, not am Wolfgangsee, but am Central Park, and in tributes to European artists, among them Robert's father, Jean Gilbert, who had become the conductor of a radio orchestra in Buenos Aires and died there in 1942, a fact that Robert only learned from newspapers. This is Hermann Leopoldi, and you have already the language, or the lyrics, sorry, of the song that we will come to in a minute, and I'll say a little bit more about the context of the song. So Gilbert began to work with Leopoldi, and the one song I want to discuss is called Da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch könnt. It would be good if one spoke English. Gilbert and Leopoldi wrote this together in 1942-43, and the song captures everyday situations, meeting people, dating a girl, trying to find a job, in which, as the title suggests, it would be good to know the English language. So you sit with a girl and the only thing you can do is get out your dictionary. Not very romantic. You sit across somebody who offers you a job, and if you can't really talk to him well enough, he won't give it to you. And then the refrain is obviously, da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch könnte. The lyrics are basically German, but in this song and in many others that followed, English idioms and phrases find their way into the text as they did into the lives of these emigres. This is the point in time and space where all the threads and topics I've mentioned so far, and which also have been relevant to Andrea's work, come together. There's the lost European tradition. Survival of something whose dimensions were not yet known. They didn't have news about what we now today call the Holocaust, not from relatives or family. Languages rather. The best decision for the artist in the midst of all these turbulences was to make the very problem he faces and which makes his life so difficult, namely the lack of fluency in the new language, the main topic of his work. His English is not good enough to write poetry or lyrics for music, so he writes a song about his English not being good enough. For the research of such stories, the fascinating thing is to see the artists at work, and I've obviously found the letters exchanged between Leopoldi and Gilbert. So Gilbert writes lyrics with an attention on the words. He sends them to Leopoldi, whose focus is on the music. He alters not words or phrases, but rhythm. He's looking for dramatic moments in the text so that he will be able to perform it. And then he sends the whole thing back to Gilbert, who adds a line or a rhyme to accommodate the musician's wishes. Georg Traska and Christoph Lind in Vienna have found a file containing some 80 pages that document this collaboration. Poems, short dialogues, and whole scenes for a play, Heimat im Koffer, Homeland in a Suitcase, a very apt name, which, by the way, was never to be written or performed until 2 years ago, I think, when a group of students in Germany staged it. It was written over, amended, typed up again, set to music, rejected, finally accepted, and in some cases also performed and published, such as this one. And now I have to ask Claire to please play for us Hermann Leopoldi, da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch könnte.
Die Sprache, noch Englisch Language, schmerzlos nach, da habe ich heute noch Schwächen. Mit Evening School, so fing ich an, ich nahm mein Englisch Lesson, doch habe ich, was ich Evenings kann, beim Breakfast schon vergessen. Man merkt mir an am Dialekt, wann ich Amerika entdeckt. Ja, da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt, bisschen mehr noch als how do you do. Denn solange man noch sagt, I can't understand, gehört man nicht really dazu. Und solange man nicht weiß, dass a brush is a Bierstel, a dog is a Hund, hot dogs, das sind Bierstel, solange bleibt man das, was man Greenhorn nennt. Darum wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt. Man stellt uns einem Sweetheart vor und möchte sie gern entflammen. Da steht man wie ein Ochs vorm Tor und stottert was zusammen. Und ist sie trotzdem leicht impresst. Und wenn die Träume reifen, so dass es Zeit wäre, zärtlich fest nach ihrer Hand zu greifen. Doch was dann kommt, enttäuscht sie sehr. Man greift heute bloß zum Diktionär. Ja, da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt, bisschen mehr noch als how do you do. Denn solange man sein Sweetheart noch Schatzel nennt, da hört's einem gar nicht erst zu. Und solange man nicht weiß, dass ein Fussel ein Kiss ist, ein Kiss schon genügt, dass die Miss wird zur Miss ist. So lang kommt man nicht zu einem Happy End, darum wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt. Zuerst lernt man das Wörtchen Schuhe, dann lernt man, I am busy. Will einer von mir Geld retour, dem sag ich, take it easy. I need a job, heißt, ich bin Stier. A carpet ist ein Teppich. A boss, das ist ein großes Tier. Und Refugee heißt Neppich. Bei einem weiß ich mir noch keinen Rat. Wie heißt denn dort das Götz-Zitat? Ja, da wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt, bisschen mehr noch als how do you do. Denn solange man dort nur zur Verwandtschaft rennt, da lernt man nichts Englisch dazu. Und solange man dort trifft, nur die Onkeln und Tanten, die Cousins und die Schnorrer und andere Verwandten, solange lernt man reden nur mit den Händen, darum wär's halt gut, wenn man Englisch kennt.
As Europe became more and more cut off during the war, Gilbert strove to make the United States his new home. The unpublished poems and songs show an effort to integrate American culture into his work and to become an American. He writes, as far as I'm concerned, I am living in New York since 1939. Ich lebe in New York. And I'm a permanent resident there since I have become, as I like to say, not just an American, but an American Indian. Nicht nur ein Amerikaner, sondern schon ein Indianer. Based on the few letters and documents kept today in Berlin's Academy of the Arts, Gilbert's feeling of having arrived reflects his personal and family situation much more than his professional career. He did not manage to integrate into the American musical industry. Europe, on the other hand, in these years seemed very far away. It was nearly impossible to receive news from friends or relatives. As the whole continent was under Nazi occupation, a black hole that had destroyed the flourishing culture of the past, unless it had in tiny trickles, escaped to so many places of exile. Gilbert made the journey back across the Atlantic, mainly for financial reasons. Only 4 years after the end of World War II, he left the United States for the first time in 1949 with the intention to find work in Europe while remaining a US citizen and resident of New York. In his letters to Rudolf Weiss, he presents himself as a kind of American uncle who sends parcels to friends and inquires about the situation over there. Between the lines, though, one feels in his writing an urgent need to reconnect. Whereas Hermann Leopoldi was celebrated in Vienna upon his return, although obviously the story of his persecution under the Nazi regime was rarely mentioned, Gilbert kept his distance. He stayed first in Munich, writing lyrics and poetry for the cabaret Kleine Freiheit, and slowly built up new networks of contact and collaboration, both in the theater and in the emerging post-war German film industry. Towards the end of the 1950s, a new area of work opened up for him quite unexpectedly. Frederick Lowy, formerly Friedrich Löwe, 1901 to 1988, the author of the musical My Fair Lady, asked Gilbert to produce a German translation of the play's libretto. And you see, Löwe, as it says in the caption, going over a tune with Alan J. Lerner. So these are the two people who made My Fair Lady. So finally, the songwriter's transnational and translational experience started to pay off. The English language that he had never mastered well enough to write became a tool of transmission and bridge building. In the years that followed, Gilbert, now based in Minusio, Ticino, in Switzerland, and very decidedly not in Germany again, translated around 20 popular American musical comedies into German. With his moderation of a dialogue between the English and German languages in plays such as Annie Get Your Gun, Oklahoma, and particularly Cabaret, his last translation in 1970, Gilbert helped to bring American popular culture to Europe and to make it accessible to an audience he once knew and did not know anymore, and was also quite doubtful about, obviously, because of the Nazi past at the same time. A file of letters kept today in the archive of Berlin's Academy of Arts contains the correspondence between Frederick Lowy and Robert Gilbert and documents the ongoing dialogue between the creator of the play and the words Alan J. Lerner made so famous in the original English. Gilbert was challenged with the task to translate these famous words into German. The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. On November 20, 1958, Frederick Lowy from Lerner and Lowy, 120 East 56th Street, New York, New York, writes a letter to Robert Gilbert, Villa La Mirandola, Minusio by Locarno, Switzerland. My dear Robert, I'm sorry not to have written to you before. Number one, this work is not of immediate pressure. Number two, I've been too busy with other things. And number three, I don't know exactly what to tell you. With a little bit of luck, mit einem Fingerhut für Glück, I like the best of the three so far. I could have danced all night, hätte gern die Nacht durchtanzt, still hasn't found my full enthusiasm. I suppose it has to do with the weakness of the first line of the refrain. Now, the second version of it I like, of course, much better, with the exception of the first line, which again is very weak. Ich hätte am liebsten heute. On the street where you live is, of course, very nice, but again, fails to excite me. It is unnecessary at this point to tell you they're all excellent lyrics, and my admiration for you remains undiminished. It just isn't quite right for My Fair Lady. Dear Robert, I know that this is going to be tough work, but we must not forget that this is My Fair Lady, which means it must be perfect. And there's no time limit on this. Please be not disappointed and keep on trying. As to your question about which dialect to use in German, I would suggest that you look up and see what they did in the German Pygmalion versions previously, for as you know, it was done in German, Vienna. Much love, Fritz. Two Germans communicate in English, and how German this English is, and hopefully sounds when I read it. And they give us an amazing insight into the workshop. Today we know, because we've heard it and seen it on the stage so often, that reads mit einem klein bisschen Glück und ich hätte getanzt heute Nacht, and somehow we see the translator sweating at his desk. Fritz, the old friend, is quite demanding, and the famous wording, which you will see and hear in a minute, had not at all been there from the start, but had been worked out sentence by sentence, verse by verse. It had not even been clear from the start that the German play would use the Berlin dialect. There is a Viennese version as well, and dozens of adaptations in other languages. But for me, Eliza Doolittle could only Berliner. Nur ein Zimmerchen irgendwo. All I want is room somewhere. How else should that sound? But it hasn't fallen from the skies. It has been compiled and developed and discussed between 56th Street in New York and Villa La Mirandola in Minusio. So you have the same picture, obviously, and now we come to the German version. On January 21, 1959, Gilbert sends a letter to Blücher. Work-wise, I spend a lot of time in Munich or Vienna as it comes. Now I'm translating My Fair Lady into German. A tough cookie, since it is so matted or felted with the English language, and purely English associations, Bezüglichkeiten. So here is My Fair Lady in the German version.
Also versuch's nochmal.
Es grünt so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen.
Was war das?
Es grünt so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen.
Nochmal.
Es grünt so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen.
Ich glaub, jetzt hat sie es. Ich glaub, jetzt hat sie es.
Grün so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen.
Bei Gott, jetzt hat sie es. Bei Gott, jetzt hat sie es. Noch einmal, wann ergrünt das Grün?
Die Blüten erblühen.
Und was macht dann das Grün?
Es grün so grün.
Es grün so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen.
Bravo! Es grün so grün, wenn Spaniens Blüten blühen. In Hartford, Hereford, Hampshire.
Hagen in Free State and Hamlum. Ich weiß, wie gut sie zu mir sind.
Noch einmal, wann ergrünt das Grün? Und was macht das blöde Grün?
Back to series. Recent research in translation studies has developed new questions in the context of cultural translation. As the organizers of a conference at the University of Graz in Austria postulate, these new approaches abolish the dichotomist or binary conceptions that are still only present even in research and cultural transfer. The attention now turns to places of contact and of fraction, zones of transition, displacements and forms of intermediation in the processes of cultural exchange, but also to those differences that evade translatability or are indeed not translatable. This might sound a little too sophisticated for My Fair Lady, but Robert Gilbert, in his own and more beautiful language, puts it quite similarly. A transition, displacement, intermediation, and exchange form indeed important elements in a life trajectory characterized by ruptures, wanderings, and relations between different worlds. And it is the notion and the practice of translation which brings these elements together. This is how he expresses it himself. Between two languages, there are delicate and fragile bridges above an abyss of misunderstandings. Should it happen that one of them wants to get to the other and that they meet on an internally swaying, shaking, wobbly surface, call them idiom or dialect, slang, jargon, lingo, literary or spoken language each, and exchange a greeting, then we can never be sure if they both mean the same, even with the simplest how do you do or guten Morgen. Often, therefore, they pass each other silently, or even worse, they talk at cross purposes. This is Robert Gilbert speaking himself in a text that I first discovered in the archive, but then also found printed in a paperback edition of My Fair Lady. The difficult business obviously has challenged him to try and write down his thoughts about the newly acquired or required form of art. So again, from that same text, Gilbert on translation. In such a case, it is common that an adventurous border crosser appears, usually called a translator. We'll try to create a liaison or connection between those two ambiguous tongues, a reasonably sustainable connection, which means he endeavors honestly and literally in the sweat of his brow to make a halfway meeting possible and to prevent, on the one hand, the emergence of a space of banality within which the simplest yes or ja will be rolled out into platitude, and on the other hand, to prevent them from landing in the abyss of misunderstandings from where no bridge wanderer will ever return. A bridge wanderer, a border crosser, these seem to be apt descriptions for the role of a translator. Like others before him, Gilbert also uses an image which makes sense only in German. The Übersetzer has the task überzusetzen, to ferry over, like an old ferryman, to walk between the colors of the rainbow, to think in terms of siltation or dilution, of ballast and babble, or splashing of maelstrom and recess, and he names the two claims made on him from the left and from the right. Fidelity, where the foreign original is concerned, and loyalty in regard to his own tribe, the German language. He sees himself swinging to and fro like the perpendicular of a grandfather clock, or balancing on the very thin thread of synonyms, juggling 17 dictionaries, as he says, on the tip of his nose. Only the self-evident becomes evident to others, would be the fitting motto for him who calls himself a mere echo, mediator or middleman with only one hope, that he will be perceived of as close as possible to the homely and neighborly voice from next door, wahrgenommen beinahe für die allen so traute und nachbarliche Stimme von nebenan. So many of these notions would seem to deserve elaboration. Surely homely, traut, and neighborly, nachbarlich, immediately remind us of the contrary, the experience of being made foreign by the power of Nazi law. It is more than any other play cabaret which brings this experience back to Gilbert's mind. It is set obviously in Berlin, and the play unfolds before the background of the Nazis' rise to power. In a letter to Friedrich Thorberg, Gilbert confirms that his own experience, the fact that he had been an eyewitness, qualified him for the translation of this play. Ich lebte dort, ich kenne die Zeit, die Sprache, das Schweigen. I have lived there, I know the time, I know the language, I know the silence. The authenticity of his translation has been emphasized by Tatiana Shestakov in her study on cabaret, where she writes that a musical like cabaret, with its linguistic and cultural duality, which seems logical considering the history of the play and the genres, requires a translator who would to some extent have the same split personality, or rather split nationality that the original play has. Robert Gilbert was the perfect interpreter, who, as a German and a man of the theater, operetta, cabaret, and himself the author of cabaret texts as well as soldier of the First World War, could become Christopher Isherwood's and Joe Masterov's German language voice. Only he had the profound knowledge of the political, social, and historical aspects of the source and target societies. I come to the last part. The cases I have explored in the study push against the recent tendency in the areas of cultural studies, diaspora studies, or postcolonial studies to frame symbolic homelessness and cosmopolitanism as the only possible form of existence in modern times. This trend may reflect, in some ways, the general experience of mankind in the 20th century, but it is also a very specific experience, and also a very specific Jewish experience, which cannot be easily translated into a kind of role model for other migrant groups, or indeed for the exiled situation of modern man and woman today. Heinrich Blücher writes a wonderful letter in 1960, "I try to imitate you." Gilbert, I try to use German as a literary language in such a way that it is determined by an inner Berliner diction. Gilbert's poems, Blücher says, have managed this challenge. The German language has been too complacent, even submissive to the Nazi conquest. If there is resistance, if there is love and real nourishment, it needs to be rediscovered in the language of the city. So we can say that the lost arena of Berlin has been the foundation of something to which the newly acquired but never completely inhabited arena of New York, even under the circumstances of emigration and exile, has added another something. What this something might be in the context of translation seems hard to define. I can only advise the German speakers among you to have a look at Robert Gilbert's Leierkasten Odyssee, which in Hannah Arendt's words have given Berlin and Berlin's Mund- und Denkart, vernacular and mindset, a place in world poetry. This mindset may be comparable to what Peter Gay has termed the Berlin Jewish spirit and qualified with the subtitle A Dogma in Search of Some Doubt, has also been represented and expressed in writing by Hans Sahl. I have no evidence for any meeting or contact between Gilbert, Leopoldi, and Sahl in New York, but we can easily imagine them sitting together in a Manhattan cafe, reminiscing about their former lives in Berlin and Vienna. The fact that we know quite a lot about Hans Sahl's experience is due to the result of an impressive research conducted by Andrea Reiter. So this is a page from a manuscript of Hans Sahl's memoirs, Die Wenigen und die Vielen, The Few and the Many, novel of the time, that has been published first in the 1950s, forgotten and later republished, and wurde von really sweet, his signature, in Erinnerung, or zur Erinnerung an New York, herzlichst, Hans Sahl. Andrea's book, The Exterritorialität des Denkens, Hans Sahl im Exil, published in German in 2007 and still awaiting translation, is an extraordinary study of a figure whom she defines as der Exilant, als Mittler. Even this is hard to translate. Der Exilant, the emigrant, the exile, the refugee, the person forced to live in exile, als Mittler, intermediary, mediator, broker, go-between. Hans Sahl was born to a well-off Jewish merchant's family in Dresden in 1902. He studied art history, literature, archaeology, and philosophy in Munich, Leipzig, and Breslau before becoming a journalist and writer who, in the short period between 1926 and 1932, contributed essays, film reviews, and feuilletons to papers such as the Berliner Börsenkurier and the Montagmorgen. In 1933, he emigrated via Prague and Zurich to Paris. Originally a supporter of the political left who sympathized with the communist dream, he opposed developments in a number of German exile organizations, including the Schutzverband Deutscher Schriftsteller im Ausland, which were more and more dominated by the communists and excluded social democrats and liberals, good colleagues among them, from their ranks. So persecuted by Nazism and shocked by the political events in Stalin's Russia, a relatively small but outspoken group of intellectuals emerged who all suddenly found themselves between the lines. We know of Arthur Koestler, of course, in Britain, Ignazio Silone, Manis Berber, and others belonged, if that is the right term, to this group that has been termed die Renegaten, the Renegades, in Michael Overs' study of the same name. In 1939, Sahl was interned as an étranger indésirable in different camps in the south of France before he escaped to Marseille in 1940 and supported Marion Fry's attempts at saving European refugees. In 1941, he managed to arrive in Portugal himself and found a ship that brought him to New York. In the years of exile in New York, Hans Sahl started to write his memoirs, which have later been published in two volumes, Memoiren eines Moralisten and Das Exil im Exil. But he also worked as a translator, translating the works of American authors such as Maxwell Anderson, Arthur Miller, Thornton Wilder, and Tennessee Williams. A streetcar named Desire became, in German, Endstation Sehnsucht. The emigrant infight between supporters of the Soviet Union and universalists continued during the early years of emigration. Sahl particularly detested Bertolt Brecht and Leon Feuchtwanger. And again, we can imagine the degree of isolation and loneliness that was the consequence of this position between all lines of fire. While most of the other political refugees returned to Germany or at least to Europe after the war, Sahl, with the exception of an unhappy period between 1953 and 58, remained in New York and has often been regarded as the last emigrant. So this is Hans Sahl, whom I've met in 1990. I have become an extraterritorial person. I've made a pact with outland or abroad, der Fremde. I can't live without it anymore, without this feeling of not being completely at home, a guest in foreign cultures. Regarded as the last emigrant until an improbable but really beautiful love story in high age brought him back to Germany and to Tübingen of all places where I did my PhD. 1989, where I met him and was a witness of the rediscovery of a forgotten author who would finally be acknowledged and awarded the literary prizes he should have earned much earlier. This rediscovery has also sparked Andrea's interest in his work, and her book is the most beautiful form of reverence imaginable. I think that there's a kind of logical and admirable development in Andrea's academic work. After graduating in German literature at the University of Salzburg, where she also gained her PhD, Andrea published Narrating the Holocaust in 2005. She then moved on to her work on Hans Sahl. She co-edited with Anthony Granville two volumes of the yearbook of the Research Center for German and Austrian Exile Studies, I Didn't Want to Float, I Wanted to Belong to Something, Refugee Organizations in Britain, and Political Exile and Exile Politics in Britain after 1933, before turning again to her home country of Austria with contemporary Jewish writing, Austria after Waldheim. These are the titles of the three books. Interestingly, Andrea herself published the English version of the Jewish literature in Austria after Waldheim first, if I remember correctly, and only then the German, also part of her own trajectory from the German to the English language. Her book on Hans Sahl, therefore, has a kind of middle position in the body of her work, combining elements, research questions, and thoughts about the study of the Holocaust with ideas about the ways European societies lived with the memory of the 20th century. In this middle, we find her thinking and writing about a figure of the intermediary and the in-between, a translator. To conclude, New York in the 1930s, with Gilbert and Leopoldi writing and composing the song you have heard, can be described as one of the arenas that the project I mentioned earlier should investigate. To think about Jewish places as arenas where translation and transfer between Jews and non-Jews and between different groups among Jews occur. How do translation and transfer contribute to placemaking, both in the actual and in the virtual space? Secondly, to further develop the idea that Jewish life and identity have always been shaped in processes of dialogue with other groups, both in contact and conflict, of co-construction leading even to co-constitutionality, as Stephen Eschheim put it. But how has this been expressed in language? And thirdly, to think of Jewish spaces in terms of exchange and negotiation rather than in terms of unidirectional processes. How important is translation? I will end with these questions, and I hope it has become evident how important Andrea Reiter's contribution was and is in the field that brings together literary and historical research and creates a new cultural history of translation in the processes of migration. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joachim, for a very subtle, sensitive exploration of this question of translation. So I will stop sharing, and we have one question already in the chat, but please feel free to add more questions or to raise your hand. So Anushka is asking, how are elements of the Jewish identity and experience shown here amongst more general expression of German exile and the problems of language?
I mean, most of these people that I mentioned, Robert Gilbert, Werner Richard Heimann, Hans Sahl, never left the Jewish community, but also didn't really regard themselves as Jews in a religious sense. Discovered their Jewishness when they were being made Jews and outcasts in Nazi Germany. Their language is German. It's not a a Jewish dialect of German, very obviously. But I do think that the experience of migration, of not belonging, is obviously ingrained in Jewish history, and the thread has been picked up by these artists when they then started to write poetry and novels, but particularly poetry, I would say, in emigration. When you take a close look at the work they did before and after, you obviously will find hints, particularly in Weißenrössl, there's a Jewish figure on the stage. There is maybe for the first time after Shylock and Nathan the Wise, neither a bad nor a good Jew on the stage, but a Jew as part of the fabric of that city of Berlin. And I think this is the memory they took with them. And this is again something they could find again in New York, in those circles in which they moved.
Thank you, Maya. Do you want to ask your question, Maya?
Not really. I write better than I speak.
Okay. Well,
so it becomes mine. Thank you, Joachim, for a wonderful paper. And I thought was really struck by the writing process of Davos, and how different it was for from the writing process of the translation of My Fair Lady. While in the song Davos, we have the text taking up the major role, and it's kind of music is set after the text in a sense. But in My Fair Lady, we have the opposite happening, which I found really interesting. Then if you could expand on the dialogue between translation and music and how music might have affected the translation process.
Well,
sorry.
I'm really not a specialist on music, but Gilbert was used to collaboration. So usually what they did, Gilbert and Heimann in the Berlin years, they would sit together, Heimann at the piano, and then they would start throwing balls at each other, musical and lyrical. And there are famous examples where they, for example, write Das gibt's nur einmal, which has a very simple melody from Der Kongress tanzt. But both of them think that can't be that this music doesn't exist yet. So they need to go to their own musical archives in their heads and maybe to a real musical archive, say, no, it hasn't been created before, but it seems that if it had been there all the time. That's one story I remember from the sources. For My Fair Lady, obviously, this is why I showed these two scenes that are obviously the very same scenes and then dubbed in German, then it doesn't work completely well. So the first sentences when Audrey Hepburn starts talking are somehow muted. You don't see her lips moving. So here's indeed the music, the dominating thing. But Löwe was sure that it would require such a big effort to adapt the words to the music. Otherwise, it wouldn't be My Fair Lady. It had worked so well in English. Now it needs to work in German. Yeah, we can only start thinking about it or continue to think about it, but I can't really respond much more.
Thank you. Are there any more questions? Please don't hesitate to switch on your cameras and talk. I have one.
Okay.
I wonder if you could say more about how this exile in the States, which didn't seem to really be a success, as you said, professionally, and he didn't really integrate, maybe on the private side, but not on the professional side. And he seemed, the impression the examples you gave is that in a way he brought his German identity to the States rather than in a way he Germanized, or I don't know, he did not really immerse himself, or I don't know, that's the impression that it gave. So I just wanted to know how this experience of the exile, do you think, had an impact or was reflected in then his work as translator, and in particular in the translation? So did he get anything from the American culture, literature, music, poetry?
I mean, this story is, of course, part of a larger story. There has been a cultural relationship between Europe and the United States in popular music before, obviously. So, for example, the producer of the operetta Im Weißen Rössel, Eric Charell, had traveled in the United States and seen the Ziegfeld Follies and other groups, and brought girl troops, these machine-like revue girls, to the Berlin stage. And others traveled to Europe, obviously, and brought parts of the European tradition to the United States. So it's not a clear-cut European culture meeting a clear-cut American culture, but it's already open in certain ways. Then he was surely interested in American poetry. Whitman, I think, particularly everything referring to New York, but not able to express it correctly, if you want, in the right language. So, like many emigres, he turned back. He wrote about his childhood and about his life. He wrote about Berlin. He missed Berlin, very obviously. He wrote many, many letters as well, which... here's the police in the background. that maybe could be published one day. Sorry. But he added his German Jewish experience together with many others, and particularly with these Austrian people who were much more, I don't know, more outgoing, to the kaleidoscope that New York already was in a certain way. But he clearly felt that he wouldn't make it professionally in terms of career, and that this is why he wouldn't make it. But he was never completely at home again in Germany. You find English idioms and phrases in his German letters after the war. This is just what happens, I think, in these processes. Mm. The German title is indeed My Fair Lady. They couldn't come up with anything better.
Okay, any more questions?
I have another question, is that okay?
Yes.
Thank you. Another thing that really struck me now when I was going through my notes again is that Hans Sahl referred to himself as extraterritorial. Mm. And do you think it would be possible to approach the idea of the exile translator as being someone who's outside of space, without space, beyond space?
Beyond a space of belonging, beyond a fixed space, beyond describable. but I mean, obviously we're not extraterritorial in the sense that we can float around somewhere, but the lines have been cut, in a way, for those who had to emigrate. Surely not German in the sense as Weimar, Berlin, Germany before 1933, this is not to be reconstructed. Surely not American in the full sense, but I guess the bridge wanderer, to use Gilbert's notion, surely. I mean, there has been this image, Hans Sahl, he is the last emigrant, and he still writes for Neue Zürcher Zeitung and Süddeutsche about American theater. And when he finally came back, he said, I would have returned if somebody had asked me. So it's also a feeling of being forgotten, being neglected, being not regarded as fully belonging anymore, I guess.
Yes, it's not always that kind of conscious decision in that sense, or like deciding that I'm not belonging in that sense.
Yeah, and I guess once it happened to you that somebody has taken away your feeling of home, you won't get it back. Not in the first generation. Marianne, Gilbert's daughter, lives in Connecticut and she has become American. So it takes a generation or two.
Thanks.
Yeah, true about Hannah Arendt, obviously, although she also kept her very German accent.
I will read the question just for people who don't have the chat. From Jonathan Leader, quite a contrast with Hannah Arendt, who was very at home in America and loved to use phrases like when the chips are down and when the chickens come home to roost in her serious writings. Jonathan, do you want to...
Yeah, no, it just struck me listening to you, Joachim, that if Hannah Arendt seemed to take to English maybe a lot more easily than Gilbert, and something I've thought about a lot, because it jumps out in the middle of the origins of totalitarianism or in the essays on between past and future, and you're in this very intellectual, very wide spanning essay, and suddenly you'll have one of these phrases or whistling in the wind, and she likes to actually use them. So when the chips are down is definitely a popular one with her, and I wonder the extent to which maybe they all got together and like to practice their English and see who could come up with these neat little colloquialisms and phrases and.
I mean, surely both she and Heinrich Blücher also had students.
Yes. Yeah, very much. Yeah.
And I think this daily contact or regular contact, at least, with people who just speak the language and nothing else, is different from Gilbert's experience, who never made it out of these exile circles where everybody was glad to sit in the Viennese cafe in the evening and be able to talk German again.
Yes.
I think she not fled, but she wasn't so much part of these exile circles and had other opportunities to integrate.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah, she had the friendships, but they were sort of with individuals and they would meet and they would talk, but she mixed in other circles with other sorts of people. Yeah. Yeah. Although also wrote for Aufbau in the early days.
Of course she did. Yeah.
Thank you.
Kendrick,
do you want to come in? Okay.
Yeah. All right. I'll try. This is a very inchoate idea. It struck me one of the few things I know about My Fair Lady is that Audrey Hepburn wasn't actually singing the songs herself, and that led me to start sort of wondering about the different levels of kind of displacement and alienation that sort of exist within these sort of cultural forms, and how. And is there a way of thinking about those in association with the actual experiences of sort of spatial exile and the kind of translation process that you were talking about? I don't. It's a very inchoate inquiry, but I don't know whether you've got anything you could say about that.
I think it's a great question, but I really have to think about it. And for Leopoldi and Gilbert, they both played the piano and sang. I think the mechanical part was really integrated for them. It was part of what they were doing, and they were performing.
Okay.
At the same time, Gilbert had a lot to do with film. I don't think Leopoldi had, so that could be an interesting part. How did they integrate the songs into the film? Partly it's completely illogical, of course. It just that there had to be songs in the film, but in Die Dreifunder Tankstelle and Der Kongress Tanz, it comes across as very organic in a way. But of course there are displacements when you make a movie. You can stop and you can restart, and it's all very different from the theater. I mean, Julie Andrews had to sing on stage on Broadway, and in a way, it's a shame that she wasn't asked to perform in the film. yeah, I can only add some incoherent thoughts and think more about it, but it's a great question.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we will stop here. There is a last comment from Devora. Okay. Oh, yeah. Thank you for a fascinating tour and also a nostalgia trip that I think will lead me to share my family with my kids this weekend. Okay. And other thoughts on Arendt, her own Americanisms, etc. Okay, thank you very much.
Maybe just shortly, sorry.
Sure.
What mentions here is the interview with Günter Gauss. Günter Gauss was a German journalist who had a series of live talks, one-to-one, and it's a time when they all still smoke and drink on TV, so it's fascinating to see Günter Gauss and Hannah Arendt in a cloud of smoke discussing her life and her work, and she keeps trying to tell him that she's not a philosopher, but a political scientist, and you learn a lot from it. But obviously, I think there's a subtitled version somewhere, but a lot is indeed about the German language that they all love so much.
It's on YouTube.
With subtitles?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So then... Right.
Okay, brilliant. Mark Spearing, do you want to?
Yes, and really just to thank Joachim for a fantastic lecture, a fantastic Montefiore lecture. I know Claude Montefiore will be looking down on us very proud, and I'm sure Andrea Reiter as well. So a very fitting tribute to both of them. So many, many thanks, Joachim. And as a humble engineer, I have been forced to contemplate things that I've not been forced to contemplate before. And even the title, the translation as a creative response to the experience of exile, you've truly done it justice and made me think quite deeply. And I now know the rain in plain falls mainly on the Spain. Quite a different German translation, as my limited German lets me recognize. Joachim, many, many thanks. And many thanks to Claire.